But joining me on the show is six-time Grand Slam champion, Sania Mirza. Sania, that itself, you know, makes this Olympics a big occasion for you. Tell us about going into your fourth Olympic Games and how different it will be from the all the other ones that you've been to.
Well, I think that if somebody told me at the last Olympics that I'll be here for another Olympics, I would have probably laughed about it. So the fact that I'm here, and it's obviously special for more reasons than one. A, it is my fourth Olympics, hopefully. B, it is after having a child, which is something that I'm very, very proud of, to be able to put myself in a position to compete at the highest level after having a baby. And I hope that, you know, that can be an inspiration for some young women and young mothers out there to sort of say that you don't have to give up on your dreams. If you have a kid, you can still follow your own dreams. And of course, every time that I've played at the Olympics, it's something that is very close to every athlete's heart. It is something that we all dream of growing up as children, to represent your country at the highest stage of sport. And Olympics is one of those podiums that we can, you know, proudly say that we are representing our countries at. So it is very special always to be at the Olympics, and I've been privileged enough to be at three, and I'm really looking forward to the fourth one.
You know, if someone told me, how would you define Sania Mirza in one word, I would say the one word that comes to my mind is resilience. What to you is that one word that defines Sania Mirza today?
I mean, I don't think I can define myself in one word, to be very honest. I think it'll take a few adjectives for me, because I think that what you see from the outside is maybe resilience. What I go through on the inside and what happens on the inside is something that, you know, is far more than just resilience. It's a grit. It's a lot of determination. It's a lot of proving the naysayers wrong many a times. It's going against the odds many a times. And I think that every young woman athlete from our part of the world will understand when I say how much more difficult it is as a girl to achieve things in a male-dominant career. And that is a fact. So I think that for me, definitely resilient is one of the words that I would say. But I think I'm very proud of the longevity that I have shown in my career, to be here over four Olympics and four back-to-back Olympics is something that is I'm truly, truly proud of that.
And you know, that's exactly what I wanted to ask you, Sania. It takes beyond resilience, it takes to keep your mind and body in sync over this long a time, and particularly we have had one long year of pandemic when most people couldn't play any sport. So how did you manage to do that? That's also perhaps a lesson to keep your mind and body in sync.
Yeah, I think that the whole world was going through, or is going through, a very, very difficult time. And it started kind of in March last year, I think, for us. And it's kind of been off and on since. And we've just seen one of the worst last few months. But I'm glad we're over it as a country a little bit. We're heading in a better direction. I think that the most important thing, especially what I was trying to do, was to try and stay as positive as possible. It's a difficult thing for me because I'm generally not the most positive person. I'm a pretty realistic person. So I'm very like, I don't really, you know, just look at, oh my God, it's such a bright sunny day. I'm not one of those people. I am a person who looks at things realistically, life realistically. And it was a difficult time, even personally, because we were away from my husband. We were stuck in another country for 7 months, myself and my son. We were stuck in India. He was stuck in another country. We didn't know when we were going to see each other. We didn't know if we were ever going to play sport. I worked really hard for over a year to make that comeback in Australia last year, made that comeback. And obviously it was really good. And then the pandemic hit. I've been asked this question so many times, and I've always said, I don't want to make the pandemic about myself. There are far, far, far larger things in the world that we're all dealing with. But as athletes, yes, we had, but like any other professionals, I think we all had our difficult moments during the time, whether it was mentally, physically, career-wise, financially. I think everybody struggled in their own way. So for me, just to stay motivated, it was important to sort of keep working, keep trying to say, you know what, if we are going to come out of this, and hopefully we're all going to stick together through it, and we're all going to come out on the better side of it. And that is something that really kept me going.
Also, Sanya, you didn't get visas easily to go out and participate in the events in the run-up to the Olympic Games. How was that, and how difficult was that getting over, you know, all these bureaucratic tangles that an athlete has to deal with? And then you had to kind of isolate from your son also for a while, I believe.
Yeah, actually, he's in the other room right now. I saw him day before yesterday, the first time in the last 9-10 days, because him and my sister had to isolate. They didn't get that exemption that was required to get into England. So they were in the quarantine, which was the government quarantine, and I had the exempt as an athlete. And for some reason, you know, they were not one of the essential part of my team. I'm not sure how, but anyway, that's what it was. So we needed to deal with it. And I think being an athlete in these times of, you know, any career is tough enough, but being a mother who has to travel week to week, you know, with a toddler or with a young toddler is definitely not easy. And it's got its own set of challenges. And like you rightly mentioned, I had a lot of difficulty with the visa situation to start with. Then I had even to the last moment, we weren't being able to let aboard the plane. I mean, the plane was leaving in 5 minutes and there was an issue with the visa. So it was very, very dramatic, everything. But hey, we're here. We're at Wimbledon right now. And that's the most important thing. I'm with my son. My sister's been a great help. Honestly, who really, really helped me in this whole process was Mr. Kiran Rijiju, our sports minister. He really, really backed me up. He was literally he was one phone call away every single time I called him, and I really don't think it would have happened without his help. And he deserves a lot of credit. The Sports Authority of India, the top scheme people, all of them, like, it was a collective effort in me being able to compete here. And that's what, you know, and I think that's what it is about. You know, it takes that team effort for great things to happen. So I'm really truly thankful to everybody that played a part in me being here.
Sanya, before we get to talking about sport, I'll have to ask you one other question about, you know, going to Tokyo in these times. Are you taking Izan along with you? Because we've heard about, you know, strict quarantine rules there as well. And how, as a mom, are you going to be able to manage that?
Yeah, no, I so far, I think he's not going with me. So at this point of time, unless, you know, but like I said, I did speak with the sports minister and I did ask him if it would be possible. And he said that he would try to do everything that he can. And obviously, as we all know, it's not really in our control. It is what, you know, sort of the boundaries, sort of, so to say, or their own set of rules that Japan is coming out with. So we're just going to have to see. We're still about a month away. So let's see mm-hmm. you know, what happens. But obviously, that doesn't change anything from me going to the Olympics, or me being able to focus. And that is part of a working mother's life. And that is a mother's guilt. I'm sure if you're a mother, you will know. And there's a mother's guilt always involved when you leave a child, even if you don't put him to bed one night, and then you feel that, you know, you should have been there. But we can't always be there. And that's okay. I mean, as long as he's okay, he's healthy, he's in safe hands. I think it was more difficult to have him in isolation in a room rather than him being at home with my family or with his father or with my sister and my parents. You know, it's a lot easier when he's in a more familiar situation. And during the Olympics, that's what I will do. If he doesn't go with me, he will be at home either in India or in Dubai, and he'll be with the family. So I have nothing to worry about.
Another working mother who has pulled out of the games is Serena Williams. She's not going to be there in Tokyo.
No, I think that I think everybody has a right to their personal choice. I don't think there's anything to comment about that. I think Serena's been at a lot of the Olympics, and she has already won a few golds. And I think that, you know, it is what you feel like. Nobody has the right to say that this is the right or wrong thing to do.
Mm-hmm. Sanya, talking about your lead-up tournament, which is Wimbledon, tell us who are you pairing with this time around, and, you know, playing the Wimbledon in the lead up to the games, how is it going to then help you?
Yeah, I mean, Olympics is very important, but Wimbledon is equally important as tennis players. You know, we don't have the luxury, like a lot of sports, to kind of focus on one tournament at a time. We have to go back to back as tennis players, and we're lucky that we get four Grand Slams a year and we get Olympics every 4 years. So I'm not really going to call Wimbledon a warm-up to the Olympics. Wimbledon is still Wimbledon, and it's a Grand Slam, and it's just probably one of the most important tournaments of my life that I've been able to win and be competing at. I am going to be playing with Bethany Maddox-Sands, who I've had
one of your very good friends on the tour.
Yeah, she's actually one of my closest friends in life as well, not just on the tour, and we've gone through a lot together. We keep joking about how, you know, there are so many young girls now out here, and we're still keeping the 80s flag flying high. So that's where we're at. And yeah, it's a lot of fun playing together. We haven't played together in a while, but we're really looking forward to it. She's coming off a fresh French Open final as well. So we're looking forward to it. We still have a few days to prepare.
Of course, the big news is that you picked Ankita Raina as your partner to play the doubles. What was really the rationale behind picking Raina?
I mean, I've known Ankita for a long time. She's about 27, 28 years old now. So she's not that young in terms of tennis age. But, you know, I've seen her since she was 15 years old. We've been at a lot of tournaments and Fed Cups together. It's been really good to see her be so disciplined over the last so many years, of over the last 12, 13 years, and really work hard. And I think her discipline is probably her biggest strength. She wakes up every morning and she puts in that 100% effort every single day. And you know, that's what you expect from her. She's obviously been playing good over the last few years, and she's someone I had a women's doubles partner in the last three Olympics who were obviously not close to being in the top 100. She's 95 to 100 in the world. She's a part of the WTA event. She's part of the Grand Slam qualifying event. So she is around this kind of level. She understands the level that's going into it. And she's a very, very nice girl. So we've got to spend some time together before the Billie Jean King Cup as well. So it was an obvious choice. She is the best player in the country right now.
Talk us through the chemistry between the two of you. There has to be an on-court chemistry for you guys to play together.
Not always. There are many people who don't get along, play together, and win a lot of titles. But I think that we have a lot of chemistry off the court. We have, like I said, I've known her for a long time. We got to practice together just before we went to Latvia. We were in Latvia together. She's someone who's was really good about her. She's very curious about the game. She always wants to learn. She always wants to ask questions, and she is right there. And I think that that's really going to help. She plays the backhand side of the court, and I play the forehand side, so that's another advantage. And I don't think we're definitely the favorites to go out there and win medals, but at the end of the day, you know, we get in there with an outside chance, and anything can happen.
Well, this is sport. Anything can happen, really, Sania. And going into your fourth Olympics, you know what I was reading, that you are going to be playing at the Ariake Tennis Center, where you won three titles. How important is it for an athlete to be knowing the arena that he or she competed in? And does the familiarity really help?
Yeah, I mean, it does in terms of, at least I know, like if I can picture it, if you tell me where I'm going to play, I know that center court, I know the courts outside, I have been there many times over the last so many years. But having said that, you know, you don't know how the courts are going to play, because every year the courts play different. They do relay courts every year. So usually the courts over there do play kind of fast, which I really like. Hence, I've had really good results over there. But we'll see this time. And but most definitely, I think it's good to go to a familiar place. It's not that overwhelming. But again, you're going you're just going for another tournament is different to how you feel when you're stepping on the court when you play Olympics for your country. So
is it easy to go from grass to hard?
Nothing about any of this is easy. So I mean, it's not easy, definitely. But we do have about maybe 10 days before we get into the Olympics. So we have enough time to make that transition. Usually about for me, it's different for everybody. For me, about 4 to 5 days playing on a different surface usually is enough to make that transition. The toughest transition, according to me, though, is from clay to grass. I think that going from slow to fast is much harder than going from fast to slow. So.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So, Sania, being there, going to Tokyo, have you figured out what the quarantine rules will be for you? Because we have been reading for the Indians, it'll probably be difficult, though we still don't have the clarity whether it's about the Indians traveling from India or for all Indian, the Indians traveling to Tokyo, quarantine rules are going to be different. What we read last week was that, you know, the Indians have to stay 3 days in isolation before they are able to step onto the court. So any clarity coming in for you at this time, how would it be for you?
Honestly, right now, I'm not thinking about it. Right now, I have to focus on Wimbledon. And that is something that as athletes, we need to do. We can't really think about what's going to happen a month from now. The situation and that we are in with this whole COVID is difficult. And it's very, very difficult to travel in this situation. So we just have to deal with it. I mean, I think that is probably an athlete talking to you, that whatever comes our way, we just deal with it. And that is how it is. And whether we have to stay in isolation 3 days or we need to stay in isolation for a week, if that's how it's going to be, then that's how it's going to be. We can crib and cry about it, or we can just take it head on and say, okay, this is what it is, and we're going to have to make use of whatever best is possible. So there is no ideal situation, so you just have to, you know, I'm just looking forward to going, and we'll figure it out as we go along.
Sania, is the 7th Grand Slam on your mind before the Olympic title now?
Yeah, I mean, I've been able to play at, I think, 11 or 12 finals and been able to win 6 of them. So it would be pretty amazing to be able to win a slam before I retire again. So I don't know if it's this one or if it's going to be the next one or the one after that, but it would be pretty incredible for me personally to be able to win another slam before I retire.
Sania, one of the talking points in the world of tennis now is, you know, players not wanting to interact with the media, particularly Naomi Osaka, saying that it puts a lot of stress on her and she won't be talking to the press in Tokyo. What are your thoughts about, you know, interacting with the media? Of course, you are sitting down for an interview with me, but generally, do you think with a lot of young athletes, media interactions do put a lot of pressure?
Well, I can talk about personally. I can't really talk about what Osaka feels or anybody else feels. I can talk to you about what I feel. And what I feel is that I went through a lot thanks to the media as well. Very young in my career when I was very, very young. And it did put certain kind of pressures on me, which were not necessarily related to tennis, or even if they were related to tennis. And at no point is it easy. And I think that many a times people tend to forget that we as tennis players or athletes or people in the media, so to say, or public figures are subject to emotions, whether that is an emotion that we feel is not right, whether that's an emotion of sadness or happiness or whatever the emotion might be, or anger. And I think that people expect us to always be proper and always show up, and which is fine. I mean, you know, we got to show up. It's part of our job. Do I think what Naomi Osaka is doing is right or wrong? I don't think I can comment on that. I think everybody has to deal with their emotion, how they feel. If there are definitely days I don't feel like talking to the media and I don't talk to them. And there are days that I'm absolutely fine with it. So everybody has their own sort of way to deal with things. And for me, I've had a love-hate relationship with you guys. And I would like to say more love than hate. I enjoy it, and I think it's a lot easier at 34 to deal with that rather than dealing with that at 21. At 21, I definitely didn't enjoy it the most. But it was something that you had to do. It is something that you do, and it's something that you have to deal with. So it's part of our job, and there are not always good things part of every job. So there are some things that are not great about that job, or you may not like. But I think media and public figures go hand in hand. And that is something that we at least I have been able to accept. So,
and so what would you really tell the young and upcoming athletes? And it's not just about the tennis players, but you know, athletes across the board. What would your advice be to deal with situations like this?
my advice to everybody, whether it comes to media or more social media rather than media, I think today social media is what is really the toxic part of it. It's not really, you know, the media. There are still very, very good media houses, and there are very good questions that are asked, and there are a lot of good answers that are given. It's the social media that really takes a toll on you as a public person, so to say. And my advice always has been, even to myself, not just to the young athletes, that don't take it seriously, neither the good nor the bad, because social media is not real. And a lot of that is not real. It is impossible for everyone to be on a holiday at Maldives all the time and be happy all the time. It is not. You see what people want to show you, and you show what people want to see. If that makes sense. So you gotta take everything with a pinch of salt on social media, and really not take it seriously. I mean, I put stuff on social media, or you know, or whatever, and it's not something that is like what my day revolves around. I mean, that is one moment of my day, and that's it, and I move on. So you cannot take the good seriously, and you can't even take the bad seriously. You just have to kind of, it shouldn't be so important in your life to give it that much importance.
Sania, you know, what we were talking about initially, and we digressed a little bit to talking about media and social media, is mental health. You know, there's a lot of talk around mental health also. As an athlete, are you happy to see that, you know, the talks around mental health are now in mainstream media? Earlier, we rarely would hear about people being talking about mental health and being empathetic.
Yeah, I mean, mental health is something that is very important. It's for me, it's as important as physical health, which is why I've got a team that works with me as much on mental health as much as it does on physical health. Because if you're mentally not in a good state of mind, you definitely cannot on or off the court be or perform to the best of your ability. And for me, being a mother takes a lot of emotions out of me, and being a professional athlete also takes a lot of emotions out of me. So it's a very high emotionally charged job that I have, these two jobs. So I think that mental health is something that needs to be spoken about. I'm glad that it's being spoken about. I have had my bouts of depression. I have gone through them many, many years ago. I found help. I had a good family that supported me through it. And I was never really scared to talk about it. I don't think it was something that I was trying to hide. But I'm very glad that people are coming out with, especially, you know, when high-profile people come out with it, I think it encourages people who aren't high-profile to say, even though they are the best in the world at what they do, they still have mental health issues, and they're not ashamed to talk about it. And I think it's very important, because we are also going through a very difficult time in the world, where we all need help emotionally and mentally for different reasons, like we mentioned in the first question. It is not an easy time to see so much death around us. There's not an easy time to see so much illness and sickness and losing loved ones. I know about 15 people that died personally from COVID. You know, so it is not easy, and I think it's important to talk to people about it.
Sania, we've spoken about mental health. Tell me, physically, are you the fittest right now? The super mom, Sania Mirza?
I don't know about the fittest. I'm fit enough, but I think I have been fitter before I had a baby. When I was, I mean, I am 34. I'm not 24 anymore. In tennis years, 34 is quite old.
But age is nothing but a number, Sania.
I agree. But it's not something, I think that, in my honest opinion, I think I have been fitter. But do I feel fit? Yes, I feel fit. I think that as athletes, we always have our own standards of fitness in our head. So maybe for a normal person, I am fit. I've put in the work that I need to be here. And hence, you know, I've been able to get back after losing 26 kilos after having the baby. So, I feel pretty fit, and I feel good physically.
A fit and driven Sania Mirza, you are. An inspiration, truly an inspiration of the nation, and wish you all the best to go out there to the park and win a medal for us.
Thank you.